Evolution has yielded us some pretty interesting skills. Sure, as a species, we've been telling oral histories for tens or even hundreds of thousands of years, but this pales in comparison to the amount of time that we've been hunting and gathering. Our brains and our bodies developed over millions of years of roaming the savanna, looking for areas with food and scoping out different types of nuts and berries and interacting with all the different types of critters we found along the way. Why does this matter? Well, it means that we can not only spot an approaching predator very quickly, we can also remember visual information or pictures far faster and with more clarity than we can remember things like spoken words. This skill is super useful if you, as a Paleolithic hunter-gatherer, need to remember where you saw that herd of buffalo going, or what that berry looked like that made everyone really, really sick. Because of this evolutionary development, visual information is simply easier to recall than auditory information. It also has to do with the fact that pictures are more heavily encoded and they speak to different types of working memory buffers, as we mentioned before. Pictures are imbued with rich and detailed information, such as color, context, shape, and size, and they're more likely to have a higher number of neural connections, as they convey emotion and depth, interaction, and so much more. As they say, a picture is worth a thousand words. Visual information is also alarmingly fast. Research has demonstrated that we can comprehend the contents of an image in just a fraction of a second. To demonstrate this, I want to walk you through an exercise. I'm going to show you a picture, and I'm going to show you this picture for a pretty long time, 2 whole seconds. And I want you to try and understand as much detail as you can about it. What are the people doing? How are they feeling? What is the context? Are you ready? Now, you just saw that picture for a pretty short amount of time, but I bet if I asked you to, you could write me at least a paragraph about the colors and the composition, where things were laid out, and what the meaning and significance of the photo is. Perhaps you could even write 2 paragraphs. Or maybe, if you're a particularly good writer, you could describe it in 3 paragraphs of 1,000 words. Ultimately, a photo is just information, and what you just did is the equivalent of reading information at something on the order of 30,000 words per minute. That's 3 times faster than the world record speed reader. Look at you, you evolved person, you. It's totally amazing. This little demonstration shows us just how effective it is to see things as pictures and symbols rather than auditory information. For this reason, in addition to all the other steps we have to take to prime our memory, it's best that we also learn to transform concepts, ideas, and other important information into imagined visual pictures, or what we call markers, as soon as we possibly can. It won't surprise you to learn, additionally, that the best and most memorable types of visual markers are strange, bizarre, or emotionally connected to memories. After all, adult learners need to connect information to pre-existing knowledge, and as always, our hippocampi are busy working away to determine what stuff matters and what stuff doesn't. The same is true of images we're hoping to remember, but we'll be covering that in a little bit more detail soon. For now, I want to tell you a pretty interesting story that actually happened while I was building the original version of this course. I was chatting with a neuroscientist from Austria about the process of learning and neural networks and things like that. More specifically, we were discussing the process of learning languages and why it was that she was struggling so much to learn new vocabulary words. The conversation progressed towards the various different ways to learn and what types of things she found easier or more difficult to remember. It was then that she recanted a story to me from when she was in med school, long before she started to understand how the brain functions. Now, apparently, one of her first tasks was to memorize all of the bones in the human body, which is a pretty momentous task. She explained to me that she struggled a great deal with this first memorization assignment. This was because they were simply looking at the bones in a diagram, a very undetailed image in a textbook without any emotional connection or experiential component to it. She said she struggled and struggled, but then one of the next assignments she had was to memorize all of the ligaments in the human body. Now, this may sound even more daunting because there are over 900 tiny little ligaments throughout the entire body. However, the way that they learned that as a class was by dissecting a cadaver top to bottom. She told me, quote, "I promise you, I'll never forget a single ligament in the human body." Now, one thing that really caught my attention is how she described the experience. She told me, "Those images will never leave my mind." Now, I think it's important to draw a conclusion from this, and it's important to realize that in both situations, both the textbook with the bone diagrams and the cadaver, there were images involved. However, the detailed, experiential images, the emotionally significant experience of interacting with a dead body, and the very concrete, minute details are what allowed her to memorize the ligaments much better than the bones. This is actually a really interesting segue because in the next sessions, we're going to be talking about what types of images are poignant and most memorable. We're also going to talk more about how we can better store images laced with significance and meaning to improve the chances that they end up in our long-term memory. But before we do all that, we suggest checking out some of the recommended materials in the PDF syllabus for some really awesome podcasts, some great books, and some inspiring TED Talks that describe the amazing power of visual memory. In the last lecture, we told you that one of the goals of superlearning is to transform any and every piece of information you want to remember into an image, which we call a marker. Perhaps this struck you as odd, or perhaps you wondered how exactly this is possible. Indeed, one of the areas of difficulty that has emerged since the original course is one of creatively generating markers for the information students may choose to learn. This is because, it takes creativity to try and rapidly generate a mental image for things, especially if the things you're trying to generate images for aren't something simple or basic. Sure, just about anyone can conjure up an image of a coffee cup, but what about generating an image for an abstract concept like evolution? Now, that takes creativity, or at least a Google image search. Fortunately, it turns out that creativity is something we're all born with, and although we lose it through our conventional education and maturity, we can easily gain it back with just a little bit of practice. For some of you, this practice won't be too necessary. Many of you are already highly creative and will have no difficulty generating these images, but for some of you, it will be a bit of a challenge, but it's nothing you can't overcome with a few short sessions of practice. Now, it turns out that Dr. Lev has actually written entire books on the subject of creativity, and so he's shared a very lengthy blog post for this lecture on how you can shift your thinking towards creativity. It goes into some of the thought exercises and behaviors you can assume in order to become more creative, and you should make sure to check it out on the PDF syllabus. Additionally, there's one simple exercise used by professionals in schools all over the world that can be highly effective at testing creativity and at re-stimulating the mind to think creatively and develop the thought patterns. It's called the multiple uses test, and it goes like this. Grab the nearest object to you. Perhaps it's a pen, perhaps it's a keyboard, perhaps it's a sheet of paper. It doesn't really matter. Now, write out as many uses as you can think of for that object. Chances are, if you're about average, you can think of around 20 uses. And even if you generate 20, you'll probably find that they fall into about 7 plus or minus 2 chunks of similar uses, or things that are really close to one another. You see, even when being creative, your brain is constrained by the ways you've traditionally used it. But what if I told you that oftentimes, children can think of 40 or more uses for any given object, with dozens of completely different chunks. They're able to think extremely creatively, describing the pen as a jousting sword for a mouse, or a balance beam for a miniature gymnast, or a flagpole for a colony of ants, and many more things that you and I probably wouldn't have thought of. The beauty is that within a few sessions of practicing this exercise for just a few short minutes, you can actually kickstart your creativity and get it back up to those higher levels. Very quickly and with a little bit of practice, you'll realize that you can approach the objects or anything from different perspectives. Where most adults get stuck is that they don't realize you can change the object and still use it. You can break the pen, take the ink, and turn it into war paint. You can take the spring out and use it to protect your iPhone cable. But you can go much further, thinking about things that are completely unrelated to the object, things you may like or dislike. Now, think again about the object and see how it could relate to that scenario. Using the example of a pen, I could think about how much I enjoy flying a drone and then consider that the pen could be used to decorate the drone or to put a little flag on the ground where the drone takes off. You get the idea. By going from the perspective back to the object, you unlock a whole new layer of potential uses that most adults don't even consider. All of this practice will greatly help you when you have to think of novel images to represent abstract intellectual concepts like evolution. We're also training your visualization skills, which, as you've probably guessed, are going to be absolutely critical in the coming weeks. In the PDF syllabus, you'll find a couple articles with exercises and strategies to improve your creativity. I hate to sound like a broken record, but it is up to you, as a self-directed adult learner, to decide if this is something that you need to invest your time in. Previously, we talked about how images in general are some of the most memorable pieces of information for our minds. Now, there are different types of images, of course, and different types will be more effective for different types of people. In the next section, we'll work on improving the types of images we imagine, and more specifically, their quality. So don't worry if you don't understand this stuff just yet. For now, though, let's do a really quick test to determine what types of images are most natural for you to imagine. We're going to determine if you naturally gravitate towards a stereotypical image, a personal image, a fictional image, or a graphical image. From there, we know what types of images you should be imagining and which ones will be most effective for you as we move throughout the course. So, I want you to imagine a coffee cup. You can close your eyes if you want or keep them open, but imagine that coffee cup as vividly as possible. What is the design of the coffee cup? How tall is it? How full? Now, what type of image did you choose? Is it a stereotypical coffee cup that you might have seen in a catalog? Is it one that you just made up? Is it a coffee cup that maybe you remember from a previous experience? Or maybe it's actually a drawing of a coffee cup. Now take note of this because this is most likely your ideal style of image. Of course, if you can choose a coffee cup that already has those neural links, such as the one your mother used to sip from when she made you breakfast, that's the best. It'll allow you to link new information about coffee and coffee cups in general to those pre-existing, deeply encoded memories. As you no doubt remember, connecting new information to existing, strong, and interconnected neural networks is probably the best way to guarantee that the hippocampi will start paying attention. Sometimes you'll get personal images, and sometimes not. Sometimes you'll have the same image for a concept, and sometimes it'll be a randomly generated one. When I picture a coffee cup, it's sometimes red and sometimes yellow, but it's never a coffee cup that I've actually seen in the past. It's just a random imaginary image of a coffee cup with slightly rounded edges and a white brim. Ultimately, you have to learn to go with what images come naturally for you. Try to lean towards whatever type of image you find most conducive for you to remember, but just make sure that number one, there is as much detail as possible. You're not just picturing some vague image of a coffee cup, but a red coffee cup, about half full, with a little handle and a textured finish. How sharp are the angles? What shade is the color? With time and practice, you're going to learn not just how to generate these images extremely quickly to represent anything you want to learn, but also to link them to other pieces of information. You'll also probably develop fixed markers for subjects that you spend a lot of time reading about. I, for example, always visualize the same image from a particularly memorable lunch I had with a friend at Facebook headquarters every single time I read about an article with Facebook as a company in it. With time, you too will build up a visual library like this one, which will make calling up images much faster and make it much easier to link together strings of images to form complex concepts that easily convert into long-term memories. Don't worry, we'll be there before you know it.